Dude, it has been more than a minute, man. It has been a couple years since you and I...
unkind and haven't invited me, Wally.
You know, I'll be honest with you. The first year, there was a reason I didn't invite you.
Okay.
And it was after Truett passed, your son. And I didn't want to be that guy that was the fringe work friend that was like co-opting off of your grief and being like, hey, let's talk about this and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I legitimately, purposely stayed out of your world.
I understand.
A couple texts here and there, you know, but I to let you know I cared, but I really didn't want to be that guy. And so that's why.
That's kind-hearted of you, seriously. Yeah. Like it is. It was a rough time. I didn't do much of anything for quite a while. I did shows.
That's
but I
hard.
Did shows because I felt like I needed to, you know, to be moving and doing something. But I didn't do a lot of interviews because it would have been tough.
Absolutely.
Like you're saying, exactly what you're saying.
Absolutely. And I mean, honestly, like as a dad, like Truett and my daughter were the same age.
Yep.
And, you know, it was, I can't imagine that, you know. And so for me, I was like, okay, I want to be respectful, honestly. And, but then the time just runs into one day after another. And the next thing you know, you're like, how do we get this old?
Yeah.
You know?
I definitely think that.
So since we haven't talked about it, are you good with talking about Truett?
Yeah, I am.
Okay.
I am.
Because here's the thing. I was at the service and there was a marked difference between you and your wife, Amanda, in how you were approaching it. Mm. You were trying to find, from the outside looking in, my perspective, you were trying to redeem this and find the good and find hope in it, and your wife was mad, you know, that it went down the way it did, and I respected both because I get both feelings and emotions and stuff like that. How is Amanda now? Are you guys? Did you guys come to a place where you're more in the same place on the same page with this now? Or are you still processing it differently?
Probably not. We're processing it differently.
Really?
I think everybody grieves a little differently. I had a guy that I met in San Antonio, and he lost his son, and this is before I lost Truett. And he said, look, I'll just tell you, I said, how's your relationship with your wife? And he said, it's good, but I'll tell you this, it's really hard because you have to give each other room to grieve differently.
Mm.
And this is before I lost Truett. It was almost like I felt like God was being kind to me because he's the first guy I called, and I barely know the guy. And there's a lot of things he told me that I took with me and have leaned into in the last 3 years. I have a kind of relationship with God where I kind of just like, all right, you're my king and I trust you. Amanda has a much more intimate relationship where she literally will get upset with God about things and really talk to him. And like sometimes she'll be crying in the other room or yelling or laughing. And it's amazing when she's having her Bible study. If I'm on the outside sometimes we do it together. But and I'm more like, okay, God, I don't like this at all, but you give and take away.
Right.
Which is really hard to even say, right? Even in this moment right now. But I trust you. And I want to be grateful for the 21 years you gave me. Even though that was really hard to say, then it's still emotional to say even this moment. Whereas Amanda honestly sort of wants vengeance, not on God, but she wants God to do kingdom work because we lost our son. Like I want a million souls, you know what I mean? Something like that. I want for that one life. That's what I want.
It.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. I get
so
that.
So it's just, it's slightly different, but you know, We are doing well.
That's good.
We talk all the time about it. We sometimes things come up where I say something and she doesn't like the way I said it, you know, about what happened. Or it's just tough. It's always it, you know. And I'm being very transparent, probably too transparent right now. But it's tough. But we're working through it every day, and it's made us really strong together.
That's good to hear, because I mean, it's a sad fact is a lot of marriages don't survive because, like you're saying, everybody grieves differently, and sometimes it can be seen as, you know, she could probably perceive you as like being okay with it, and when she's like, "This is not okay," and you're like, "Well, I'm trusting God for my next breath here," you know.
That's right.
And because it was interesting watching you at the service, and I watched you I was a bawling mess, and I watched you head down, your foot going, and your hands were down, and I'm just watching you kind of shake a little bit. And I watched you then look up and then raise your hand. But it seemed like that was the hardest hand raise that you've ever made in your life, I would think.
Yeah, it probably was. I my whole thing at this service was, if you had told me from the beginning that my firstborn son was going to live for 21 years, would I have taken it? Would I have taken the deal?
Yeah.
And my thought was, I would. I would take it 100 times over, 1,000 times over, because those 21 years were amazing. And he's an amazing person, and I'm honored to call him my son.
You know, when your kids have problems, there's a tendency to judge the parents, you know, and losing Truett the way you did, like to an overdose, you know, did it make you more cautious about sharing the story based on what you do for a living, you know, and being a Christian artist? Did it make you go, I don't know what I can share of this or when?
No, because
good.
Honestly, because I've always lived my life as an artist and my songs really transparent. I try to write about what I live. I was just walking through the house yesterday, and this song, old song of mine, came to my mind. Well, I'm right here and you're right there, and God knows we got to start something. That's me and Amanda just talking about, you know, differences. And I just think I've always lived that way. I wasn't trying to hide anything or cover anything up. I mean, Truett was a man, and he lived how he wanted to live, and he was an interesting young man because he was super passionate. He struggled, but he was super passionate about the things of the King, the things of God. I mean, his last text to Amanda was a psalm, and he texts Amanda the verse, and he said, "Mom, is God tickling me?" And I just think, like, that's a real relationship.
Right.
If you imagine the King of Glory tickling you, you have an intimate, real, personal relationship with him. There's no doubt in my mind about that. You guys don't know him, but you knew him. But the way I know him is he just loved God's word. But he had a struggle. You know what I mean? He had a struggle. And it wasn't a long struggle for years.
Right.
This was like literally a mistake he made, just being really transparent with you. Sometimes we hear these stories of people getting, you know, going through rehab time after time after time, or overdosing time after time, and still making it through. And we're grateful for that, but we're like, oh God, couldn't you just give us one or two where he pulled through? And it was really, you know, the first time he had bought anything that wasn't prescription. His first thing, he bought something off the streets, you know, and I've never really told anybody that.
Yeah.
But the first time, and it's tragic. I mean, it's really hard, man, but I lay my life and everything that happens in it at the feet of the King, and that's what I fight to do. It's hard sometimes. Sometimes I don't do it. Sometimes I'm angry, but I lay it at the feet of the King.
Like, how do you... Because you don't move on. I think you move forward, you know? Like, because moving on tends to have the connotation of forgetting. Moving forward is processing and living, you know? But how do you balance that with, like, people around you and things where you're like, you know, it's kind of like a kid on American Idol. Like, they win American Idol, or they're on it, and they're always so-and-so from American Idol. And eventually that has to stop, and they create their own career. And it's like, so that you don't become... the guy that, oh, that's the guy that lost his son, you know? Like where does that transition happen so that you still honor Truett, but you still move forward? Like, do you feel that at all or no?
Yeah, I mean, I do. Yeah. I do. I feel it all the time, because I feel like if I'm going to sit and talk to Wally today about this, I owe Wally, and I owe my son mostly, I owe him taking the time to really talk about it the way... how I feel about it, not to brush over it.
Right.
So you feel that way, and you, yeah, I don't know. I think that you just try to move forward every day, and I think that it's important that you don't forget, and that we have services at the farm, at the Harnsdale, and we'll just laugh and cry and remember every year. you know, on his birthday and on the day he passed, because we don't want to forget.
Yeah, and you want to remember the good stuff, too, eventually.
Oh, we do.
And we laugh
our heads off sometimes at how he was and what a wild man he was. He'd come in the house, you know, get riling up all the little brothers and sister and just, like, creating chaos. When he lived in Nashville, when he wasn't living with us, he was still recording all his music in our basement. So that was important to me. We talked a lot about him getting another studio, and I kept going, I think you're good. Because I wanted him to come home every day and record there, you know what I mean? So, and that was happening. He was living in, like, East Nashville, but he was driving to Franklin, to our basement to record. I mean, it's hard, but you remember with all your heart, and you walk forward. And we have been surrounded by love.
Yeah.
Our family around us, that our friends, our community, really been very kind, and even the people out there that listen to my music, and you guys, the people that work in our industry, have been very kind, very kind. Like, there wasn't a moment where we didn't absolutely feel surrounded by love, and that to me is what the body of Christ should feel like. So I'm really grateful for
that. That's cool, man. Like, what would be a word that would describe you then? Because I think it's important. And the reason I ask this, I think it's important because people look at your story and they can imagine the hurt, pain, grief, or whatever. But then if you stay there, then it's like, oh, that doesn't honor Truett either, you know? And it's like, so what would be a word that described you then when this happened, and a word that describes you now?
That's a tough question. I think then when it happened, I was just a mess, man. I was broken. And I think now there are a lot of moments of brokenness, and there's never a moment where I'm not thinking about him. Honestly, I can honestly tell you that.
I believe it.
I do imagine Truett a lot, and I imagine him in this way. I don't imagine him like just in heaven. He's up there.
Right.
I only imagine him saying, Dad, if you could see what I see now. And I'm not talking about Jesus. I'm not even that spiritual about it. Like, if you could see how this story works and how it works together, you'll just want to be here with me. This is a tapestry that God put together, and I'm walking in faith, trusting that. And Truett is saying, if you could only see it, what I see now, Dad, it's okay. Mm. And that's how I feel now.
That's awesome, man. Well, your new album, Life After Death, has songs on it like Help Is On The Way.
Help is on the way, coming for.
Everything About You with your daughter Marley.
I miss everything about you. I just miss me.
Yeah, how great is that?
It's special.
21 years.
God has you in heaven, but I have you in my heart.
You know, was this an album for yourself as much as for other people to kind of work through some of this?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, I'm going to write about what I'm going through.
Yeah.
I think a man and I talked about a couple things, and she helps me a lot to process. She's amazing. She's just an amazing person. Like, but processing even my artistry nowadays, not as much in the past, but now, because I feel like it represents us now. If it's about my story, I have to be a little more sensitive about my story because it involves our family,
right,
and us losing our son. Sure. I'm living. I'm here. I'm alive. My spirit is alive. God is alive in me.
Yeah.
But it's after death.
If you know, because you don't want to be the poster child for loss, obviously. No one would choose that, you know. But that's where you're at, you know, that you're in a place where you've experienced something that other people fear or are walking through and have no idea how to process it themselves. Is there anything you could give to somebody that's like going through what you've gone through, is losing a child? And any word of encouragement or advice or just insight that you've learned from this that you're like, okay, I wish I had known this, or somebody gave me this and I want to pass that on.
I think what I've really learned, and what the gentleman told me from San Antonio, he said, you're gonna want to reach up and grab on to a promise. If your mind and your heart is open to trusting God, you're going to want to reach up and grab onto a promise. And you're going to pull it down and hold it close. But he said a lot of times, you reach up and grab onto something that God didn't really promise us. God didn't promise us we wouldn't be hurt or right. We wouldn't face loss on this earth. But what he promised us is that he will never leave us or forsake us. That he'll be right there with us. He might not take away the cold that we're experiencing or the pain, but he's right there in it with us. And that is what I've really found, that he hasn't gone. He's remained.